If there's one thing that Britain is not short of, it's bullets. This splendid pairing of Blackmore Vale and 92 Squadron is an extremely rare sight, and so are double headers on the mainline. Bullets even come in blue these days. Indeed, one was painted red for a while. But if there's one survivor of Southern's Pacific Fleet that can be called the flagship, then surely it's 35028 of the Merchant Navy class, the legendary Clan Line. The story of this engine revolves around a group of people who simply wouldn't let Clan Line die. They're the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society.
Each time she goes out, there's a support crew of eight people who basically will spend two full working days before the day of the run getting the engine ready. That involves clearing out the smoke box and the ash pan from the previous trip, oiling the engine, attending to any mechanical problems that there may be, and then finally cleaning her so that she sparkles as you see her now.
It's not so much a fine-tooth comb, more like a fine-tooth brush. Every speck of dirt is removed, and some of the workers have been at it for 30 years.
For all of us, it's a labour of love. Yeah, we just take a lot of pride in it, a lot of satisfaction, you know. Anybody would be upset on the support crew if they saw a dirty mark somewhere, they'd be up there and clean it off. As they've been doing this morning, just the final touches. We cleaned it all yesterday. It's come over from Southall last night, got a bit mucky again this morning, so we all get stuck in again. As far as I'm concerned, it's the nearest thing to a living machine. She's got her character. It's the pride, I think, the pride of when she backs onto the train in Victoria, all the people are around and you can stand back and just soak it up, really, and know that you were part of it and you contributed to it being there. She's a she, has her moments, a bit temperamental sometimes, but always comes up with the goods. Well, we have a chat to her from time to time and make sure that she's happy, and she tells us if she's not. And when she's not, it usually gives us a lot of work.
These engines ceased to run in 1967. For the last three or four years of their service life, a whole group of us used to go around on the southern region, recording them, photographing them, travelling behind them. And it was fortunate that it was announced about 2 years before they actually stopped running that they were going to come to the end of their lives. And we simply decided that we didn't want to do without them. So we clubbed together and put adverts in the enthusiast press asking for donations to see if we could get enough money actually to preserve one. It was all done with the giddy innocence of youth. We had no idea what we were taking on. We had no idea what we were going to do with it if we did manage to buy it. But we persevered, and we've eventually managed to raise £2,200, which was the scrap value of the locomotive in those days, and bought it. There were, within the railway engineering authorities, enough people who were interested to see at least one Merchant Navy class preserved to be able to give us the information as to which of the 10 surviving locomotives was in the best condition. And we picked a short list of three engines, I think it was, of which this was actually number two. But the one that we were going to buy in the first place got damaged and had to be cut up. So this was the second choice, but now we wouldn't part with her for the world. Nowadays, we try to do about 20 trips a year, which is about as much as it's possible for a volunteer organisation to manage. Of those, about 15 are on the Orient Express proper, and the other 5 are reserved for enthusiast outings.
Today it's a golden arrow trip around Kent. The addition of the various bits and pieces is always a source of mirth among the support crew. As well as the arrows, there's the famous headboard to attach, if it'll behave itself and slot into place, and finally those fluttering Anglo-French flags. Planline backs out of the shed at Stewart's Lay. The Class 73 electro-diesel alongside is one of the type used to drag the VSOE stock back into Victoria Station. In fact, one of the 73s will trail along behind Clanline all day, but won't be used for banking assistance unless they're in trouble. The engine will need a good run at Martin Mill Bank near Dover, which pitches to 1 in 64. In steam days, a trailing load of 555 tonnes would never have been allowed single-headed over the bank. So, as Clanline emerges from the London suburbs, she's heading for some tough mountain climbing. During the day, with the help of special cameras, we'll be able to follow her progress in detail and, above the racket on the footplate, to hear the commentary of her driver, Colin Kurzweil. His first task is to guide the big engine through the suburban maze.
We're taking a diversion route to the down slow. So easing the regulator again, just let the train come over the top. 40 mile an hour crossover, we're only doing 30, so they have no problem with speed. 53 over the junction, I think we're cross on time.
The reason it's murder for the firemen is the stop-go nature of their progress. Clanline is climbing steadily towards the North Downs, so Jim the fireman conjures up a full head of steam. Note how the draft sucks the coal off his shovel. But just as they get going, Colin reaches up to close the regulator on the long 1 in 95 climb to Bickley. As so often happens, they're being held up by other traffic, and soon the ribbon of steam at the valves becomes a fountain of wasted power. The injectors are already on, so there's little the crew can do except tiptoe through the station with the safety valves roaring. They're using the gradient to slow the train down and trying to judge it so that they can keep moving, hoping that the signal ahead will clear before they get there. It won't be the last time today that stragglers ahead will threaten their schedule. Fortunately, the EWS footplate crew have seen it all before and will not easily be beaten. The driver and traction inspector have got nearly 100 years of footplate experience between them, and Colin's father and great-grandfather were engine men, so Clanline is in good hands.
The EWS guys are professional railwaymen who, during the rest of the week, will be driving commuter trains, freight trains, anything that comes along. When they drive steam trains, they actually volunteer for it. They're still paid staff, but because it's not part of their job description now, they don't have to do it if they don't want to. And in a sense, they're as much volunteers as the Preservation Society people. They do it because they love it. One of the most satisfying things is to see how the old skills come out and are honed and perfected with every trip. One of the measures of the skills of the footplate crew is the amount of water that the locomotive uses. And on our regular runs, we've been pleased to see that every time we go out, we use a little bit less water, a little bit less each time, until eventually I think we're going to come back with more than we started with.
A sound to send a shiver down the spine at Chilham Station, where the peace is about to be shattered. The train turned left at Ashford along the Stour Valley and is now approaching its destination, Canterbury. It'll pass the little signal box at Chartham, still painted green. Pity the old slammed-door EMU isn't in southern green. Regulator closed, Clanline ambles into Canterbury West Station, which is straddled by a 70-lever signal box of the type that used to sit across the lines at Clapham some years ago. Today's trip with the VSOE stock involves a 3-hour stopover at Canterbury while the passengers explore the city before heading back to London via Deal and Dover. It'll be a busy afternoon for the support crew. Clanline will have to be detached from the train and reversed into the up platform for watering. John the signalman gets things organised as quickly as he can so that the stock can be tucked away in the east sidings and the engine and support crew freed for watering. The snag is that they'll have to move out of the way every few minutes to make way for a service train, so it's a race against time. Working as support crew on any mainline engine requires real commitment, and it's no exception with current line.
2 full days really. I send out invites. We've got about 25 people that we use for support crew. We rotate them around, a mixture from all industries. I invite them out about 3 or 4 weeks before the trip, get a party of 8 together. We then arrange to be here for a full day before the tour, really for preparation, oiling, cleaning, start oil polishing. Do the tour on the day and either get home that night or perhaps even the following morning if it's a late tour. I don't think the health and safety executive would be too impressed, but I would have thought 14 to 18 hours. Where you're actually awake. And you don't usually get a very good night's sleep in between because you're worrying about, did we do this, did we do that? Is it all going to be okay? So it's a long day.
The passengers are beginning to drift back to find their engine temporarily in the wrong platform and minus its train. The artist will need to work quickly. His picture will have to be finished later because it's time to go. News has reached them of traffic problems at Folkestone on their route back. And 40 miles away, passing through Tunbridge, is the cause of the problem. A Eurostar has failed to retract its pantograph this side of the Channel Tunnel, and a pair of 73s rescue it. Some railway observers, who should perhaps know better, are quick to amplify the problems steam engines have, but would do well to take note of scenes like this. Any train can break down. Meanwhile, back at Canterbury, Colin's fellow chauffeurs deliver his train, giving him a few minutes to consider the road ahead.
It's a nice sunny day at the moment, yeah. But there's a prospect of showers.
Yeah.
And you're going to be going up Martin Mill, and yeah. It's not all easy, is it?
No. We always try and think, I mean, whatever you're driving, especially on the steam, 10 or 15 miles ahead, the fire is managed so you've got the steam when you need it and you haven't got too much when you don't need it. But what's going through my mind at the moment, if it's rainy or slippery going up Martin Mill Bank, we've got one in 67 in places. It's quite a steep bank, but hopefully we'll get a run through deal at 50 mile an hour and we should get up the top okay.
To look for is round the corner where the fireman will call out if the signal is off. Just looking back to make sure the train is following in a normal manner. Everybody seems happy and we're on our way. Train number should be 1600 from Canterbury, but due to operating difficulties down in the Folkestone area, there's extra traffic at.
Okay.
Slight adjustment on the regulator and the.
Right away, driver.
fireman instructs me that the next in was off, so we are now okay to proceed. Maybe a little bit too much water in the boiler, so open the cylinder cock so we don't carry any water over. Few rotations of the wheel, ease the regulator, shut the cylinder cock, and away we go.
It is a physical job, certainly, and me being small in stature, with the arrangement of the regulator on the merchant navy or the bullies, the regulator goes from a pulling position to a pushing position. And me being small, I push it so far, then I have to get my shoulder on it to open it right up into the roof, you know, and that's as it is.
Open the regulator full. 30% cut off. Speed 40 mile an hour. Jim has a full head of steam and things are looking very good.
Flashing through Deal Station after a frustrating signal stand, they're only doing 40 miles an hour, not the line speed of 50. And that missing 10 miles an hour is something they can't really afford with a towering 7 mile climb ahead of them. There are steeper banks in Britain than a 1 in 60 something, but it would be unthinkable to send a single header over them with 555 tons hanging behind the engine. Today, at Martin Mill, Clanline will be called upon to sustain a power output rarely seen since the 1960s, and even then this sort of load was specifically forbidden over Martin Mill Bank. Colin Kurzweil will later report a feeling like leaves on the line, but the camera shows something else. Weeds and grass, apparently high enough to get between wheel and rail. The engine is slipping slightly, and the cutoff is wound slowly to 55%. Will they have to call for assistance from the trailing electro-diesel? Will they hell? All the way up the bank, at full chat and with both injectors on, Bullid's brilliant boiler continues to produce a feather of steam at the valves. you can hear the engine slip again, and Colin quickly catching it. At this critical point on the bank, just when you think they might be beaten, Clanline throws off the mantle of show pony and demonstrates British steam at its very best. Martin Mill Station means the worst is over. Soon the road will pitch down sharply into the waiting jaws of Guston Tunnel.
Well, all right, Jim. Dave. Dennis. Well, all right,
Colin was checking with the traction inspector Dennis Donovan that there's enough water to cover the crown of the firebox when they tilt downhill. But with people of Dennis's calibre and experience aboard, it's really only a formality.
So we're about right time. Blow the whistle as we're going into the tunnel. It's all downhill here, so the locomotive is shut off.
As the train winds slowly through Dover's sharp curves, the traction inspector explains how steam services were operated 40 years ago between Deal and Dover.
Steam engines never, very rarely brought that load across there from Deal. 8 or 9 was their whack, their limit, and then they would pick up another 3 at Dover Priory to make their quota into London. In the summer, Deal used to become a small steam depot. So they used to have a pilot engine come on the front of heavy trains, bring the train over from Deal to Dover, come off, and then take the next one back. This here was where Dover loco steam sidings used to be there, steam depot. We're not having a rough trip round here, it's just that we're limited to 5 mile an hour.
Why's that?
Because of the curvature of the road. Get a view of the tunnel as you go up there, John. This is a very unique tunnel. This is Shakespeare Tunnel, shaped like church doors. They're single bores, interlocked by little tunnels either side of them. This is a steady old climb, all the way up to Folkestone. Not as heavy as what we've done. Steady. Going into Shakespeare Tunnel now.
The railway picks its way beneath the white cliffs of Dover through a series of tunnels towards Folkestone. Here, the train is completely dwarfed by the scenery, and suddenly the mighty Clanline is like a child's toy, a train set among pretend mountains. It's been a long day for the men and their machine, but Dennis is still hard at work at that fire and hasn't got time to admire the view from Folkestone Viaduct. They left Stewart's Lane several hours ago, so the fire is inevitably dirty. With a tightly timed sprint up the main line ahead of them, and only a brief water stop at Paddock Wood, the Bullid's rocking grate comes into its own. The two engine men compare watches, and Dennis's expression speaks volumes. They've done very well indeed to have kept time. He gets on with building a bullied fire, very deep at the back, almost blacked out under the door, with great care to build up the back corners. The doors are being opened and closed to restrict the rush of cooling air. On the easy grades of that arrow straight track between Ashford and Tunbridge, the engine's just been strolling along and loops into Paddock Wood station a minute early. Ironic that she should be making way for Eurostars, the cause of her problems earlier. At least it'll give the engine men a chance to catch their breath and to relive for a moment the engine's epic conquest of Martin Mill Bank.
Yeah, we didn't get the distance for Martin Mill, so therefore we had to creep through the station, making sure the signal on the end of the platform and the advance was off, which didn't give us a very good run at the bank. And although we had a full head of steam and a full boiler of water, it's a bit of a struggle getting up the bank. And with the gales that we've had and the rain, there were a lot of leaves laying around on the track. Therefore, you know, the engine was prone to slipping. So it mattered shutting the regulator, opening the sand, and then, you know, restarting again. But we went over the top with a full regulator and about 55% cut-off. So we had a bit in hand and there was no fear of a stalling at all. But the engine coped, as usual, magnificently. And although there's an engine on the back, it never certainly crossed my mind, and I know it didn't Dennis or Don's, that we should have any assistance. But she went up there fine. And it was nice, in a way, to come up that way rather than go roaring through Deal at 50 mile an hour and go flying over the top at 40. I very much enjoyed that.
Were you at all worried though, Colin? I mean, everyone in the support coach was saying, will she, won't she, especially when she started slipping. Were you always confident you could do it?
Oh, not even a doubt in my mind that the engine was not capable of doing it. No, there's no problem at all. Not a twinge of worry one little bit. No, not at all.
It's been another textbook performance. The driver is keen to put the praise where it belongs.
If I could just thank the people that make it possible. I mean, all the support crew, the people that turn out every week to make the engine run available for us, always in immaculate condition, mechanically and always highly polished, and they're always there. Whenever we stop, they're there to trim the coal, to take water, to do the oiling, all the things that we used to have to do. But it's all done for us now, and it's so easy.
Thank you, driver. Lovely journey.
Enjoy that. Well done. Thank you.
Like all the great railway towns, Eastleigh has seen better days. These works were built in the era of Dougal Drummond a century ago, and now time is claiming them back. But not everything is gone. Making tracks to where it was rebuilt in 1959, Clan Line comes hurrying south through Eastleigh Station on a sunny Sunday. Her destination is Southampton Docks. In the background, beyond the tall ship, is the bulk of what used to be the Southwestern Hotel, where Victorians could alight from their boat train in the foyer. The grace and grandeur is long gone. Now you have to look hard at the floating boxes to recognise them as ships at all. Once there was a complete fleet of steam locos here, the dock shunters of the USA class. Typically of steam, a few survived the loss of habitat, and this one is still bustling about on the Kent and East Sussex Railway. In steam days, with a class of 14 of these to look after the engine shed in the docks, 71i could have serviced a visiting merchant navy. But now things are more tricky for straying steam locos. After being released from the train and from her support coach, Clanline prepares to set sail on the long journey of her own backwards. For a few moments at least, road gives way to rail as the big engine reverses over the ungated crossing at Canute Road. The driver today has been involved with steam for 50 years. Rodney Tizard's career as an engineman at Eastleigh spanned an era of great change. That he should be reversing along the main line in one of Bullitt's Pacifics at the twilight of his career is something no one would have predicted when Clanline was withdrawn in 1967. He's taking the engine all the way back to Eastleigh. The 7 mile journey is being made simply to turn the engine, for there still exists a loop of track that runs right round the perimeter of the Eastleigh depot. By setting off forwards and then turning left in the Fareham direction, he can run all the way round a mile-long loop back into Eastleigh and then reverse to the docks. The poignancy of this journey isn't lost on the engine men, for Clanline is back where she was rebuilt. All 30 of the class lost their span can casing here in the late 50s. Now it's a motley fleet of diesels that have reached the end of the line, unless someone cares to preserve them. Clanline emerges from what remains of the great engine shed, where once she rubbed shoulders with Nelsons and Arthurs and Schools in a glorious jumble of southern steam. As she approaches the lines that stretch away towards Bournemouth and Weymouth, she meets, briefly, one of her successors. One day, HSTs will earn their place in preservation, but what they'll never have is the individual personality that each steam locomotive possesses.
I suppose if I had to sort of put it in a word, I would say Clanline's a bit of an introvert, because she never makes a lot of noise. There's a chattering noise from the chimney, even when she's working very hard. But quite often she can slip through the landscape and people won't even hear her coming or notice. A quiet engine that just gets on and does the job and keeps up with the modern railway.
The evening sunshine catches her exhaust as Clanline powers away from Northern Junction with the return working to Victoria. There are still enginemen around who can remember merchant navies in brand new, unrebuilt form.
When we had the new at Bournemouth, up to that point in time, we had Lord Nelson's as our mainline engines. And then in 1949, we had six Bully Pacific Merchant Navy class. And I was moved up into the mainline link, and my own engine was Portline, which is 35027. And the driver I worked with was a man named Frank Carter, and he was the finest engine that I'd ever had the privilege to work with. They were very light on coal with the right driver. I mean, the drivers made a lot of difference. And we could go, when I went to London, I could stop firing at Winchester and I could go the rest of the way without putting any coal on with that driver. And he would use the minimum amount of water, and he was the only driver I worked with that wouldn't take water at Southampton on the way to London. We had a big tender and he, no, we don't want water, mess about and take water. And always when we got to Waterloo, we had more than half a tank of water left.
By an amazing coincidence, Portline has ended up at the Swanage Railway, where Stan Symes is the senior driver. So engine and ex-fireman are reunited after half a century. Also by coincidence, Portline was due back in traffic at about the same time as her younger sister's mainline ticket runs out. But 35027 won't be roaming the network like 35028. Today, Clanline is rostered onto her bread and butter duty, a luncheon special along the line of the Surrey Hills. She's taking the VSOE stock for a leisurely ramble through Guildford and Red Hill. In fact, as she approaches Guildford, the Orient Express staff will just be serving the main course. For this is Meals on Wheels with a difference. Clanline's footplate staff are mainly concerned not to spill anyone's soup and also to keep the engine quiet on this easy bit of the journey. There'll be some energetic exercise after lunch, but first, the usual water stop at the beginning of the Dorking and Red Hill line, one of those bits of the Southern Railway that was never electrified. In steam days, there were regular workings by Western engines from Reading. It's a cross-country route avoiding London whose potential was never fully exploited, but in these days of vanishing capacity, Clanline is glad of an available path along a route near London. For a few minutes, passengers at Shalford Station are treated to the organised chaos of a water stop. It's a colourful travelling circus that will soon roll on somewhere else. John Neal is at the controls, with Don Clark on the shovel, and Traction Inspector Dennis Donovan acting as our guide to the action on the footplate.
Oh,
Okay, we've got about 4 miles now uphill, about 1 in 100. Some of it 1 in 96. If she wants to move, that is.
Come on, Bill. Shout nice and loud, then.
Sure. Yes, will do. Yes, here we go. One slip.
What's that, Tally, John? It's just quite tight, isn't it?
Corners filled up. Got about 2.5-3 foot either side there. If you lose that, you'll have cold air coming up. And at the moment, you've got a good pressure. Look at that. See the cameraman on the line side there, no vest. That's the steam heater pipe to warm the train up, warm the coach. They regulate that. Go on, Don, you work on your fire. You're coming round nicely now. There we go. Right, now we've got a full regulator. That's all about. But you're doing well. Only 40% cut off.
All three of these engine men were working on the Southern in steam days. In fact, Dennis passed his driving test on a Bullet, number 34088, so there isn't a better judge of the breed.
Every engine, even though it's the same class, it gets treated differently. You know, I mean, our Taw Valley behind us, you can bring her right up into 15 and she's steamed quite freely. That is to say, that's the cut-off, you know, you're shortening the stroke. In other words, when you start away in a car, you start away in first gear and slowly bring them up into top gear. And the same thing applies to steam engines. You actually bring them up into mid gear until you're actually racing. The cut-offs, you don't hear that when you're doing 70 mile an hour, do you? See, so you're uptight. But Taw Valley will stand for it. You know, you can bring her up nice and tight up into the middle. But if you do that with Clan Line, it baffles it a little bit. So we found that out by an error. We found that we was working a train once, so we brought her up inside 25, 15, and she wasn't steaming quite so freely. So what we do now, we drop her out beyond outside 25, and she'll hold her pressure there. That is why when we was going up the bank from Shelford there, she didn't move. She never moved that needle, and that was against the injector. They give us an average speed of about 36 mile an hour up there for 4 miles, which isn't bad for that type of load. You know. She slipped a couple of times. There is a cutting up there somewhere near a crossing. The leaves, the trees, you're going to get the leaves come down, and she, if you're not ready for it, there, she will lose her feet. And she did that on a particular day, but she got up there all right. She got there without assistance. That is without assistance. You know.
The power of bullets is easy to underestimate, partly because they don't make as much noise at the chimney as most designs.
The great glory of a Bullet Pacific, which gives it the power that it does have, is that the front end of the locomotive is very efficiently designed. All the pipes that carry the steam from the boiler to the cylinder are large and streamlined so that there's no internal resistance. The cylinders use the steam very efficiently, and finally it's exhausted through a very large chimney so that all the energy is spent in the cylinders and not wasted making a huge noise at the chimney top.
Quiet exhaust or not, they're still a gripping spectacle in full flow. Stan Symes rates them highly among the astonishing total of 100 different classes he's driven.
From a driving point of view, they're powerful, very responsive, very comfortable to drive, got a good cab, plenty of room. The steaming qualities are excellent. There's never any fear of being short of steam with them. And they had a character of their own. They were quite different than anything else that we'd ever had before. They only had one drawback, and that was the visibility, because they had a habit of forcing the steam downwards, either one side or the other. So you could go to London, and at one side the driver would see nothing at all, and in the reverse direction, the fireman saw nothing.
This dynamic duo laid down a smokescreen all the way from London to Margate, where they came to rest on an enthusiast special. But what was the identity of the Merchant Navy class train engine, which was being piloted by the familiar Taw Valley of the West Country class? Alas, Belgian Marine didn't survive. Someone had paid for the privilege of seeing a ghost. Canline was posing as 35017. Double-headed driving is an art form all of its own.
In my case, the train engine, I'm subordinate to the guy on the leading engine. He controls the brake, and all I do is apply power as I think he is. When he shuts off, I shut off power. There's no working in multiple with steam locomotives.
Later in the day, they raced all the way back to London, and there was great interest over how they'd cope with the long climb out of the River Medway Valley at Sole Street Bank. 15p is a lot of pulling power. Just watch how people step back in amazement. But this wasn't the only time Canline travelled under an alias. On a glorious winter's morning at the birth of the new millennium, she was at it again, using a false name. Glinting in the sunshine was the ghost of Union Castle. Canline had been renamed for the shipping line's centenary, and though she missed the actual date with superheater problems, the engine was making up in style for a rare lapse. having flashed down from London in crystal clear light, the engine paused briefly at Eastleigh before reappearing off shed after turning. One of the things commented on by those enthusiasts watching from the station platform was just how dramatically an engine's appearance and character can be changed by a different nameplate and by different numbers. The whole look of the machine is somehow different. Union Castle's shining moment came and went, and the evocative name passed once more into the sunset of history. But the headboard was carried more than once. This is Clanline appearing as herself, accelerating hard out of Basingstoke. It was a young driver from Basingstoke Shed who set up one of the Merchant Navy speed records in the dying days of steam.
We worked out of Salisbury up to the Greatley, and then we went over the top at Greatley, and then getting down to Redprost Junction, we were clocking 103. And that's what we were. And then I decided it was time to stop because Andover wasn't too far away, and we were stopping in Andover. So yeah, and it was actually clocked at that, and as you say, I was a young lad. What was I then? I was 29 years old, and I've just done over 100 mile an hour on this steam engine, driving this steam engine. And when I stopped in Andover, they all charged, all the spotters were on there, they all charge out the train, they want to take your photograph out of the engine. And the engine I had was 35008, and the guy come charging up and he said, 35008 is reputed to be the worst Merchant Navy of the lot. What do you got to say about that? I said, give me the best one.
For comparatively small-wheeled express engines, the Bullids were fast, and that was because they'd run on a sniff of steam.
If you are really on the move, you can pull your lever up to about 15% with a Merchant Navy or West Country, and which is quite sufficient, and that engine will be at its best at that point. You can get the speed, a Merchant Navy or a West Country or quite capable of 90 miles an hour, even more if you wanted to, but that was always our maximum, 90 miles an hour, so officially we never exceeded it.
There remains the question of why the entire Merchant Navy class had to be rebuilt from this shape to a less radical final form. Are the critics unfair to Bullitt?
It is most unfair. Chains were used for power transmission all over static engineering applications, and there was no reason to suppose that they wouldn't work in a railway engineering application. And I think, given plenty of time to sit down and work the design out in the cool of the evening, it could have worked better than it did. But you have to remember that it was designed in the middle of a world war when every second was precious, and they had to get the engines into traffic to help with the war effort. And it was the first stab at the design, and it had a few rough edges. I think you would have to say that Bullied was a man ahead of his time. He really, if you like, designed the first ergonomic steam locomotive in terms of ease of operation of the cab controls for the crew. He set out to make the steam locomotive as easy to maintain as possible. I think he realized that it would never be as easy to maintain as a diesel locomotive, but he was determined to have a damn good crack at keeping them going as long as he could. We've long since passed the point at which we've owned the engine for longer than British Railways did. She has to earn her living. Every 7 years we have to do a major overhaul on the engine, and it costs every penny that we can earn in the 7 years of running.
During those 7 years of running, Clanline has travelled widely, an ambassador for mainline steam. And who knows how many thousands of people must have witnessed her passing and felt enriched by the sight of this superb machine.
Engine was not capable of doing it. No, there's no problem at all. Not a twinge of worry one little bit. No, not at all.
Thank you.
been another textbook performance. The driver is keen to put the praise where it belongs.
If I could just thank the people that make it possible, I mean, all the support crew, the people that turn out every week to make the engine well available for us, always in immaculate condition, mechanically and always highly polished, and they're always there. Whenever we stop, they're there to trim the coal, to take water, to do the oiling, all the things that we used to have to do, but it's all done for us now, and it's so easy.
Thank you, driver. Lovely journey.
Enjoy that. Well done. Thank you.
Like all the great railway towns, Eastleigh has seen better days. These works were built in the era of Dougal Drummond a century ago, and now time is claiming them back. But not everything is gone. Making tracks to where it was rebuilt in 1959, Clanline comes hurrying south through Eastleigh Station on a sunny Sunday. Her destination is Southampton Docks. In the background, beyond the tall ship, is the bulk of what used to be the Southwestern Hotel, where Victorians could alight from their boat train in the foyer. The grace and grandeur is long gone. Now you have to look hard at the floating boxes to recognise them as ships at all. Once there was a complete fleet of steam locos here, the dock shunters of the USA class. Typically of steam, a few survived the loss of habitat, and this one is still bustling about on the Kent and East Sussex Railway. In steam days, with a class of 14 of these to look after the engine shed in the docks, 71i could have serviced a visiting merchant navy. But now things are more tricky for straying steam locos. After being released from the train and from her support coach, Clanline prepares to set sail on the long journey of her own backwards. For a few moments at least, road gives way to rail as the big engine reverses over the ungated crossing at Canute Road. The driver today has been involved with steam for 50 years. Rodney Tizard's career as an engineman at Eastleigh spanned an era of great change. That he should be reversing along the main line in one of Bullitt's Pacifics at the twilight of his career is something no one would have predicted when Clanline was withdrawn in 1967. He's taking the engine all the way back to Eastleigh. The 7 mile journey is being made simply to turn the engine, for there still exists a loop of track that runs right round the perimeter of the Eastleigh depot. By setting off forwards and then turning left in the Fareham direction, he can run all the way round a mile-long loop back into Eastleigh and then reverse to the docks. The poignancy of this journey isn't lost on the engine men, for Clanline is back where she was rebuilt. All 30 of the class lost their spam can casing here in the late 50s. Now it's a motley fleet of diesels that have reached the end of the line, unless someone cares to preserve them. Clanline emerges from what remains of the great engine shed, where once she rubbed shoulders with Nelsons and Arthurs and Schools in a glorious jumble of southern steam. As she approaches the lines that stretch away towards Bournemouth and Weymouth, she meets, briefly, one of her successors. One day, HSTs will earn their place in preservation, but what they'll never have is the individual personality that each steam locomotive possesses.
I suppose if I had to sort of put it in a word, I would say Clanline's a bit of an introvert, because she never makes a lot of noise. There's a chattering noise from the chimney, even when she's working very hard. But quite often she can slip through the landscape and people won't even hear her coming or notice. A quiet engine that just gets on and does the job and keeps up with the modern railway.
The evening sunshine catches her exhaust as Clanline powers away from Northern Junction with the return working to Victoria. Thank you. There are still engine men around who can remember merchant navies in brand new, unrebuilt form.
When we had the new at Bournemouth, up to that point in time, we had Lord Nelson's as our mainline engines. And then in 1949, we had six Bully Pacific Merchant Navy class. And I was moved up into the mainline link, and my own engine was Portline, which is 35027. And the driver I worked with was a man named Frank Carter. And he was the finest engineman that I'd ever had the privilege to work with. They were very light on coal with the right driver. I mean, the drivers made a lot of difference. And we could go, when I went to London, I could stop firing at Winchester and I could go the rest of the way without putting any coal on with that driver. And he would use the minimum amount of water, and he was the only driver I worked with that wouldn't take water at Southampton on the way to London. We had a big tender and he, no, we don't want water, mess about and take water. And always when we got to Waterloo, we had more than half a tank of water left.
By an amazing coincidence, Portline has ended up at the Swanage Railway, where Stan Symes is the senior driver. So engine and ex-fireman are reunited after half a century. Also by coincidence, Portline was due back in traffic at about the same time as her younger sister's mainline ticket runs out. But 35027 won't be roaming the network like 35028. Today, Clanline is rostered onto her bread and butter duty, a luncheon special along the line of the Surrey Hills. She's taking the VSOE stock for a leisurely ramble through Guildford and Red Hill. In fact, as she approaches Guildford, the Orient Express staff will just be serving the main course. For this is Meals on Wheels with a difference. Clanline's footplate staff are mainly concerned not to spill anyone's soup and also to keep the engine quiet on this easy bit of the journey. There'll be some energetic exercise after lunch, but first, the usual water stop at the beginning of the Dorking and Red Hill line, one of those bits of the Southern Railway that was never electrified. In steam days, there were regular workings by Western engines from Reading. It's a cross-country route avoiding London whose potential was never fully exploited, but in these days of vanishing capacity, Clanline is glad of an available path along a route near London.
That's too long, get another one.
For a few minutes, passengers at Shalford Station are treated to the organised chaos of a water stop. It's a colourful travelling circus that will soon roll on somewhere else. John Neal is at the controls, with Don Clark on the shovel, and traction inspector Dennis Donovan acting as our guide to the action on the footplate.
Okay, we've got about 4 miles now uphill, about 1 in 100. Some of it 1 in 96. If she wants to move, that is.
Come on, Bill. Shout nice and loud, Dennis.
Yes, will do. Yes, here we go. One slip.
What's that, Tally, John? Just like a minute.
Corners filled up. Got about 2.5-3 foot either side there. If you lose that, you'll have cold air coming up. And at the moment, you've got a good pressure. Look at that. See the cameraman on the line side there, no vest. That's the steam heater pipe to warm the train up, warm the coach. They regulate that. Go on, Don, you work on your fire. You're coming round nicely now. There he goes. Right, now we've got a full regulator. That's all about. But you're doing well. Only 40% cut off.
All three of these engine men were working on the Southern in steam days. In fact, Dennis passed his driving test on a Bullet, number 34088, so there isn't a better judge of the breed.
Every engine, even though it's the same class, it gets treated differently. You know, I mean, our Taw Valley behind us, you can bring her right up into 15 and she'll steam quite freely. That is to say, that's the cut-off, you know, the shortening of the stroke. But in other words, when you start away in a car, you start away in first gear and slowly bring them up into top gear. And the same thing applies to steam engines. You actually bring them up into mid gear until you're actually racing. The cut-offs, you don't hear that when you're doing 70 mile an hour, do you? See, so you're uptight. But Taw Valley will stand for it. You know, you can bring her up nice and tight up into the middle. But if you do that with Clan Line, it baffles it a little bit. So we found that out by an error. We found that we was working a train once, so we brought her up inside 25, 15, and she wasn't steaming quite so freely. So what we do now, we drop her out beyond outside 25, and she'll hold her pressure there. That is why when we was going up the bank from Shelford there, she didn't move. She never moved that needle, and that was against the injector. They give us an average speed of about 36 mile an hour up there for 4 miles, which isn't bad for that type of load. You know. She slipped a couple of times. There is a cutting up there somewhere near a crossing. The leaves, the trees, you're going to get the leaves to come down, and if you're not ready for it there, she will lose her feet. And she did that on a particular day, but she got up there all right. She got there without assistance. That is without assistance. You know.
The power of bullets is easy to underestimate, partly because they don't make as much noise at the chimney as most designs.
The great glory of a bullied Pacific, which gives it the power that it does have, is that the front end of the locomotive is very efficiently designed. All the pipes that carry the steam from the boiler to the cylinder are large and streamlined so that there's no internal resistance. The cylinders use the steam very efficiently, and finally it's exhausted through a very large chimney so that all the energy is spent in the cylinders and not wasted making a huge noise at the chimney top.
Quiet exhaust or not, they're still a gripping spectacle in full flow. Stan Symes rates them highly among the astonishing total of 100 different classes he's driven.
From a driving point of view, they're powerful, very responsive, very comfortable to drive, got a good cab, plenty of room. The steaming qualities are excellent. There's never any fear of being short of steam with them. And they had a character of their own.
A sound to send a shiver down the spine at Chilham Station, where the peace is about to be shattered. The train turned left at Ashford along the Stour Valley and is now approaching its destination, Canterbury. It'll pass the little signal box at Chartham, still painted green. Pity the old Slamdor EMU isn't in southern green. Regulator closed, Clan Line ambles into Canterbury West Station, which is straddled by a 70-lever signal box of the type that used to sit across the lines at Clapham some years ago. Today's trip with the VSOE stock involves a 3-hour stopover at Canterbury while the passengers explore the city before heading back to London via Deal and Dover. It'll be a busy afternoon for the support crew. Clan Line will have to be detached from the train and reversed into the up platform for watering. John the signalman gets things organised as quickly as he can so that the stock can be tucked away in the east sidings and the engine and support crew freed for watering. The snag is that they'll have to move out of the way every few minutes to make way for a service train, so it's a race against time.
Thank you.
Working as support crew on any mainline engine requires real commitment, and it's no exception with Clantline.
Two full days, really. I send out invites. We've got about 25 people that we use for support crew. We rotate them around, a mixture from all industries. I invite them out about 3 or 4 weeks before the trip, get a party of 8 together. We then arrange to be here for a full day before the tour, really for preparation, oiling, cleaning, start oil polishing. Do the tour on the day and either get home that night or perhaps even the following morning if it's a late tour. I don't think the health and safety executive would be too impressed, but I would have thought 14 to 18 hours. When you're actually awake, and you don't usually get a very good night's sleep in between because you're worrying about, did we do this, did we do that, is it all going to be okay? So it's a long day.
The passengers are beginning to drift back to find their engine temporarily in the wrong platform and minus its train. The artist will need to work quickly. His picture will have to be finished later because it's time to go. News has reached them of traffic problems at Folkestone on their route back. And 40 miles away, passing through Tunbridge, is the cause of the problem. A Eurostar has failed to retract its pantograph this side of the Channel Tunnel, and a pair of 73s rescue it. Some railway observers, who should perhaps know better, are quick to amplify the problems steam engines have, but would do well to take note of scenes like this. Any train can break down. Meanwhile, back at Canterbury, Colin's fellow chauffeurs deliver his train, giving him a few minutes to consider the road ahead.
It's a nice sunny day at the moment, yeah. but there's a prospect of showers.
Yeah.
And you're going to be going up Martin Mill, and yeah. It's not all easy, is it?
No. We always try and think, whatever you're driving, especially on the steam, 10 or 15 miles ahead, the fire is managed so you've got the steam when you need it and you haven't got too much when you don't need it. But what's going through my mind at the moment, if it's rainy or slippery going up Martin Mill Bank, we've got 1 in 67 in places. It's quite a steep bank, but hopefully we'll get a run through deal at 50 mile an hour and we should get up the top okay.
To look for is round the corner where the fireman will call out if the signal is off. Just looking back to make sure the train is following in a normal manner. Everybody seems happy and we're on our way. Train number should be 1600 from Canterbury, but due to operating difficulties down in the Folkestone area, there's extra traffic at.
Not yet.
slight adjustment on the regulator and the...
Right away, driver.
My fireman instructs me that the next signal is off, so we are now okay to proceed. In the boiler, so open the cylinder cock so we don't carry any water over. A few rotations of the wheel, ease the regulator, shut the cylinder cock, and away we go.
It is a physical job, certainly, and me being small in stature, with the arrangement of the regulator on the merchant navy or the bullies, the regulator goes from a pulling position to a pushing position. And me being small, I push it so far, then I have to get my shoulder on it to open it right up into the roof, you know, and that's as it is.
Open the regulator full. 30% cut off. Speed 40 mile an hour. Given us a full head of steam and things are looking very good.
Flashing through Deal Station after a frustrating signal stand, they're only doing 40 miles an hour, not the line speed of 50. And that missing 10 miles an hour is something they can't really afford with a towering 7-mile climb ahead of them. There are steeper banks in Britain than a 1 in 60-something, but it would be unthinkable to send a single header over them with 555 tons hanging behind the engine. Today, at Martin Mill, Clanline will be called upon to sustain a power output rarely seen since the 1960s, and even then this sort of load was specifically forbidden over Martin Mill Bank. Colin Kurzweil will later report a feeling like leaves on the line, but the camera shows something else. Weeds and grass, apparently high enough to get between wheel and rail. The engine is slipping slightly, and the cutoff is wound slowly to 55%. Will they have to call for assistance from the trailing electro-diesel? Will they hell? All the way up the bank, at full chat and with both injectors on,
Bullid's brilliant boiler continues to produce a feather of steam at the valves. You can hear the engine slip again, and Colin quickly catching it. At this critical point on the bank, just when you think they might be beaten, Clanline throws off the mantle of show pony and demonstrates British steam at its very best. Martin Mill Station means the worst is over. Soon the road will pitch down sharply into the waiting jaws of Guston Tunnel.
Everyone's all right, Jim? Dave? Dennis? Everyone's all right, don't
they? Colin was checking with the traction inspector Dennis Donovan that there's enough water to cover the crown of the firebox when they tilt downhill. But with people of Dennis's calibre and experience aboard, it's really only a formality.
So we're about right time. Blow the whistle as we're going into the tunnel. It's all downhill here, so the locomotive is shut off.
As the train winds slowly through Dover's sharp curves, the traction inspector explains how steam services were operated 40 years ago between Deal and Dover.
Steam engines never, very rarely brought that load across there from Deal. 8 or 9 was their whack, their limit, and then they would pick up another 3 at Dover Priory to make their quota into London. In the summer, Deal used to become a small steam depot. So they used to have a pilot engine come on the front of heavy trains, bring the train over from Deal to Dover, come off, and then take the next one back. This here was where Dover Loco steam sidings used to be there, steam depot. We're not having a rough trip round here, it's just that we're limited to 5 mile an hour.
Why's that?
Because of the curvature of the road. Get a view of the tunnel as you go up there, John. This is a very unique tunnel. This is Shakespeare tunnel, shaped like church doors. They're single bores, interlocked by little tunnels either side of them. This is a steady old climb, all the way up to Folkestone. Not as heavy as what we've done. Steady. Going into Shakespeare Tunnel now.
The railway picks its way beneath the white cliffs of Dover through a series of tunnels towards Folkestone. Here, the train is completely dwarfed by the scenery, and suddenly the mighty clan line is like a child's toy, a train set among pretend mountains. It's been a long day for the men and their machine, but Dennis is still hard at work at that fire and hasn't got time to admire the view from Folkestone Viaduct. They left Stewart's Lane several hours ago, so the fire is inevitably dirty. With a tightly timed sprint up the main line ahead of them, and only a brief water stop at Paddock Wood, the Bullid's rocking grate comes into its own. The two engine men compare watches, and Dennis's expression speaks volumes. They've done very well indeed to have kept time. He gets on with building a bullied fire, very deep at the back, almost blacked out under the door, with great care to build up the back corners. The doors are being opened and closed to restrict the rush of cooling air. On the easy grades of that arrow straight track between Ashford and Tunbridge, the engine's just been strolling along and loops into Paddock Wood station a minute early. Ironic that she should be making way for Eurostars, the cause of her problems earlier. At least it'll give the engine men a chance to catch their breath and to relive for a moment the engine's epic conquest of Martin Mill Bank.
Yeah, we didn't get the distance for Martin Mill, so therefore we had to creep through the station, making sure the signal on the end of the platform and the advance was off, which didn't give us a very good run at the bank. And although we had a full head of steam and a full boiler of water, it's a bit of a struggle getting up the bank. And with the gales that we've had and the rain, there were a lot of leaves laying around on the track. Therefore, you know, the engine was prone to slipping. So it mattered shutting the regulator, opening the sand, and then, you know, restarting again. But we went over the top with a full regulator and about 55% cut-off. So we had a bit in hand and there was no fear of a stalling at all. But the engine coped, as usual, magnificently. And although there's an engine on the back, it never certainly crossed my mind, and I know it didn't Dennis or Don's, that we should have any assistance. But she went up there fine. And it was nice, in a way, to come up that way rather than go roaring through Deal at 50 mile an hour and go flying over the top at 40. I very much enjoyed that.
Were you at all worried though, Colin? I mean, everyone in the support coach was saying, will she, won't she, especially when she started slipping. Were you always confident you could do it?
Oh, not even a doubt in my mind that the...
If there's one thing that Britain is not short of, it's bullids. This splendid pairing of Blackmore Vale and 92 Squadron is an extremely rare sight, and so are double headers on the mainline. Bullets even come in blue these days. Indeed, one was painted red for a while. But if there's one survivor of Southern's Pacific Fleet that can be called the flagship, then surely it's 35028 of the Merchant Navy class, the legendary Clan Line. The story of this engine revolves around a group of people who simply wouldn't let Clan Line die. They're the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society.
Each time she goes out, there's a support crew of eight people who basically will spend two full working days before the day of the run getting the engine ready. That involves clearing out the smoke box and the ash pan from the previous trip, oiling the engine, attending to any mechanical problems that there may be, and then finally cleaning her so that she sparkles as you see her now.
It's not so much a fine-tooth comb, more like a fine-tooth brush. Every speck of dirt is removed, and some of the workers have been at it for 30 years.
For all of us, it's a labour of love. Yeah, we just take a lot of pride in it, a lot of satisfaction, you know. Anybody would be upset on the support crew if they saw a dirty mark somewhere. They'd be up there and clean it off, as they've been doing this morning, just the final touches. We cleaned it all yesterday. It's come over from Southall last night, got a bit mucky again this morning, so we all get stuck in again. As far as I'm concerned, it's the nearest thing to a living machine. She's got her character. It's the pride, I think, the pride of when she backs onto the train in Victoria, all the people are around, and you can stand back and just soak it up, really, and know that you were part of it and you contributed to it being there. She's a she, has her moments, a bit temperamental sometimes, but always comes up with the goods. We have a chat to her from time to time and make sure that she's happy, and she tells us if she's not. And when she's not, it usually gives us a lot of work.
These engines ceased to run in 1967. For the last three or four years of their service life, a whole group of us used to go around on the southern region, recording them, photographing them, travelling behind them. And it was fortunate that it was announced about 2 years before they actually stopped running that they were going to come to the end of their lives. And we simply decided that we didn't want to do without them. So we clubbed together and put adverts in the enthusiast press asking for donations to see if we could get enough money actually to preserve one. It was all done with the giddy innocence of use. We had no idea what we were taking on. We had no idea what we were going to do with it if we did manage to buy it. But we persevered, and we've eventually managed to raise £2,200, which was the scrap value of the locomotive in those days, and bought it. There were, within the railway engineering authorities, enough people who were interested to see at least one Merchant Navy class preserved to be able to give us the information as to which of the 10 surviving locomotives was in the best condition. And we picked a short list of three engines, I think it was, of which this was actually number two. But the one that we were going to buy in the first place got damaged and had to be cut up. So this was the second choice, but now we wouldn't part with her for the world. Nowadays, we try to do about 20 trips a year, which is about as much as it's possible for a volunteer organisation to manage. Of those, about 15 are on the Orient Express proper, and the other five are reserved for enthusiast outings.
Today, it's a golden arrow trip around Kent. The addition of the various bits and pieces is always a source of mirth among the support crew. As well as the arrows, there's the famous headboard to attach, if it'll behave itself and slot into place, and finally those fluttering Anglo-French flags. plan line backs out of the shed at Stewart's Lake. The Class 73 electro-diesel alongside is one of the type used to drag the VSOE stock back into Victoria Station. In fact, one of the 73s will trail along behind clan line all day, but won't be used for banking assistance unless they're in trouble. The engine will need a good run at Martin Mill Bank near Dover, which pitches to 1 in 64. In steam days, a trailing load of 555 tonnes would never have been allowed single-headed over the bank. So, as clan line emerges from the London suburbs, she's heading for some tough mountain climbing. During the day, with the help of special cameras, we'll be able to follow her progress in detail and, above the racket on the footplate, to hear the commentary of her driver, Colin Kurzweil. His first task is to guide the big engine through the suburban maze.
We're taking a diversion route to the down slow. So easing the regulator again, just let the train come over the top. 40 mile an hour crossover, we're only doing 30, so they have no problem with speed. 53 over the junction, I think we're cross on time.
The reason it's murder for the firemen is the stop-go nature of their progress. Clan line is climbing steadily towards the North Downs, so Jim the fireman conjures up a full head of steam. Note how the draft sucks the coal off his shovel. But just as they get going, Colin reaches up to close the regulator on the long 1 in 95 climb to Bickley. As so often happens, they're being held up by other traffic, and soon the ribbon of steam at the valves becomes a fountain of wasted power. The injectors are already on, so there's little the crew can do except tiptoe through the station with the safety valves roaring. They're using the gradient to slow the train down and trying to judge it so that they can keep moving, hoping that the signal ahead will clear before they get there. It won't be the last time today that stragglers ahead will threaten their schedule. Fortunately, the EWS footplate crew have seen it all before and will not easily be beaten. The driver and traction inspector have got nearly 100 years of footplate experience between them, and Colin's father and great-grandfather were engine men, so clan line is in good hands.
The EWS guys are professional railwaymen who during the rest of the week will be driving commuter trains, freight trains, anything that comes along. When they drive steam trains, they actually volunteer for it. They're still paid staff, but because it's not part of their job description now, they don't have to do it if they don't want to. And in a sense, they're as much volunteers as the Preservation Society people. They do it because they love it. One of the most satisfying things is to see how the old skills come out and are honed and perfected with every trip. One of the measures of the skills of the footplate crew is the amount of water that the locomotive uses. And on our regular runs, we've been pleased to see that every time we go out, we use a little bit less water, a little bit less each time, until eventually I think we're going to come back with more than we started with.